And back to you now, because around that time, late 60s, is when you started to live at the residence of Amy Jacques Garvey.
Yes,
tell us about that.
I started to visit Amy Jacques Garvey from around 67,
okay,
every week, doing chores for her.
Why?
Well, my mother had told me about Garvey from I was in Port Antonio. I was aware of that. When the body was brought back, I wrote an article for my school magazine, okay, on Garvey. So I was, before I went to university, I was aware of and interested in Garvey. So this led me to inquire about his wife. And I went to her home, as was the case with so many other people, to speak with her. So from around 1967, I was in touch with her on a weekly basis. From around 1969, she allowed me to stay in her back room. So I lived there from 69 until her death in July of 1973. And I regard that as my second sabbatical, because she was a very inspiring person, a very down-to-earth woman, feet on the ground, dealing with issues which even the husband was not dealing with. I give you one example. One is this family thing was central to her whole perspective. I don't think he had much time as a political activist to pay attention to that. So she
kept set the family unit
she
together.
She kept the family unit together. She lived pretty modestly from some rent. She had a house that was rented, but never worked for anybody in her life. Didn't go out to work.
To work, yes.
Whether civil service or other things which people of her social class. And she was not a kitchen person at all. She had a younger sister named Ida, who lived in Red Hills area, who used to bring her meals for her, which last her for in 5 days.
Yeah.
And she warm it up and so on.
Okay.
But she on her typewriter, writing her letters. At that time, in typewriter, carbon paper, mm-hmm, meticulous, a copy of everything that she did. She had the Garvey and Garveyism that she had just published. She had built a storeroom at the back to keep the books, and she would mail orders that came in. So, and she had a lot of documentation and scrapbooks which she exposed me to. I would go to the institute and research for her.
Keep going.
And so we had a lively, I used to write letters. When people at that time, I don't know, you know, Jamaica has changed somewhat.
The world has changed.
People at that time used to cuss Garvey. He never done nothing for Jamaica. He was a thief. That was the normal thing that we used to do. So I used to then, she dictate to me letters. I write them, use a pseudonym, I get it published in the paper. But it's really her words I was using in these letters.
To the Gleaner.
To the Gleaner. But what I want to point out and underscore is that having been active in the United States in the 1920s and gone through all of the attacks on Garvey and the imprisonment and carrying the flag for his release, having returned to Jamaica in time to have two sons, one born 1930, the other 1933, and having people say to her when she walking in Crossroads, where you get them two little black boy from? Because she was lighter in complexion than Garvey. The Jamaican racism was very strong. But she was active in the political movement for change in the 40s.
Correspondence. She was part of the 5th Pan-African Conference in Manchester, in England. Yeah,
that's more Amy Ashwood. But she was in support, in support of it. But
Ashwood
was present, yes. So it was, she had a lot of pain,
okay,
which she
carried,
had to carry, because living in a society in Jamaica that didn't understand what Garvey had achieved and what the vision meant and how the vision could have been applied to Jamaica in the independence era was very painful. But she was very heartened by the response of the West African leaders, particularly Kwame Nkrumah, but also Azikiwe in Nigeria. And there's another person in Cameroon, a man called Bernard Fonlon, who was a historian, who kept in touch with her. And she was in touch with the Pan-African Congress, Azania. That was where she had her strong commitment, not so much to the ANC, but to the Pan-Africanist Congress and Robert Sobukwe.
Sobukwe, yes, sir.
That was
sir.
Who she felt was
great hero.
The person.
Yes.
So Africa and the, again, the emerging movement in the United States around civil rights and around black power, because she was a black power person in her 70s. Clear black power. So when these young people came to speak with her, to interview her, that was what gave her ease the pain.
Yeah.
Because Jamaica, as you well know,
very critical, of her, yeah.
Very disparaging, very discouraging.
Yeah.
So she was glad to see the emergence of Walter Rodney and the movements around change in Jamaica, which led to the 70s.
So while you were living at her place, you got access to a lot of these original Garvey documents and letters?
A lot of the original Garvey documents, letters, scrapbooks from the Negro world, her articles that she wrote, she had in those scrapbooks.
You had never swell. That sounds like a great experience, man.
It needed a team of people to work to go through all of that material, as well as to ask her the questions that needed
to be asked.
So she would basically, in the course of an afternoon, give you information that she felt was necessary for you to understand and appreciate. But
that's almost like a postgraduate course in African history.
Saying. It's a postgraduate course. It is a postgraduate course with original sources,
yes,
including one of the witnesses
icons
to the events of the 1920s.
Amy Jacques Garvey should be a Jamaican national heroine,
yes,
without question.
Absolutely.
Yes.